talking about fundamental solution, and we said that it must be a solution to this equation. When Laplacian u equals delta of x, where delta of x is the Dirac's delta function. So let's talk about this function. It will bring us to the topic of generalized functions. So first let's consider delta function in one-dimensional case. So Dirac defined this function as zero everywhere except for point zero, the origin, and infinity at the origin. And he was studying quantum mechanics. He was a physicist. So why he defined this function like that? Because he wanted this delta function be derivative of a step function or a Heaviside function. So this function equals to 1 for positive axis, equals 0 for negative axis, and there is a Max half convention that for symmetries just 1/2 when x is 0. So here is the sketch of the Heaviside function, 1 for positive, 0 for negative. And what can we see in this step function, right? If we want to differentiate this function, here function is constant, derivative is 0. Here function is constant, derivative is 0. And here there is a jump. So the point 1/2 here, that's our function is defined at 1/2, will not affect anything. But what's important, here there is a jump. And if we are talking about jump, what can we say about derivative? Well, perhaps it's infinity. That's what was Dirac's motivation. So he defined his function like this, and he wrote that delta of x is a derivative of this Heaviside function. But this created a huge problem for orthodox mathematicians. So why? Because if we start to integrate this delta function, having in mind that this is derivative of Heaviside function, so we can write integral along the x-axis, delta x dx, then we replace delta x with h prime, and then we use the fundamental theorem of calculus, and I put here just infinities. I believe you know how to deal with improper integrals. It will not affect anything. So, but then it should be just h. H evaluated somewhere here, right, in a big positive number minus big negative number, and that would be 1 minus 0 equals to 1. And so what do we have? We have that integral of this function equals to 1. But on the other hand, if we look here, right, our function is 0 everywhere except for one point, and one point has measure 0. So one point does not affect integrals. So from this point of view, the integral must be zero. So from one consideration, it's zero. From another consideration, it equals to one. So it's a problem. It's not normal function, what mathematicians said. And then later, how this problem was resolved? Way later, physicists were able to deal with such function, but in and by the way, Dirac introduces function in 1920, and Sobolev was one of the mathematicians who started working on these generalized functions in 1936, and then Laurent Schwartz wrote just a systematic book, so he did systematic study in 1950s, so it's 30 years later. And what was the main idea? If instead of just a huge jump, sharp jump, we introduced, say, delta-shaped functions, or say, delta sequence. So that would be a function, a smooth function, so a smooth function such that when epsilon goes to zero, this function approximate our delta function. So we can think of the integral of delta function from negative infinity to infinity as a limit when epsilon goes to zero of this delta-shaped function. And what do we want from this delta-shaped function? The first property would be we want the integral, since we want the integral to be one, so the integral must be one for any positive epsilon, right? So epsilon changes, epsilon can go to zero, but for any positive epsilon, the integral is one. That's why I wrote here just this, if the neighborhood is getting narrow, then function is getting high. This was the property, and this is the main property. Also, you can see that this function is non-negative everywhere, and it is concentrated on this interval from negative epsilon to epsilon. Outside this interval, it is zero. So these two conditions can be weakened, but this, the first one, is the most important. We want our integral to be equal to one. And you can find different examples of such functions, and I just wrote one example of delta epsilon, so delta shaped function. It's equal zero when x is greater or equal epsilon, right? Modulus of epsilon. And it's equal this expression for x in this interval from negative epsilon to epsilon. And c here is this constant. And you can check that this function, it satisfies all three conditions. And so the integral probably you have to calculate the non-negativity. You can immediately see, and this condition you can immediately see. And also, in addition to this, the function, this specific example, gives us also function that we call C infinity. So, and C infinity everywhere, so it can be differentiated infinitely many times and everywhere, because obviously if you have such function, right, so here it's zero, it's differentiable. Here if you have expression like e to some power, it's also will be infinitely differentiable. So basically this part where you have this connection is good to have as a C infinity, but again you can work with other sequences. This is the main expression, that's a requirement that we need. So now let's look at the properties of a delta function, right? So if we interpret it as a limit of delta shaped sequences, then the integral along the entire real line x-axis would be equal 1, right? And then delta of x would be 0 when x not equal to 0, since the limit of delta shaped functions would be 0 when epsilon goes to 0 and x is not 0, right? Those exactly properties that Dirac wanted to have. And let's consider f x, and let a continuous function, right? So here's y equals f of x, and consider the integral of f of x and delta x. So then we understand delta, of course, as again as delta shaped functions, sequences. So, and then Here we have our continuous function. Here we have our delta epsilon function. And then every value that is located somewhere here will be multiplied by zero. Right? So it will become zero. And then when limit of delta functions, when epsilon goes to zero, it will be narrow. So what points will be highlighted will be important. Only points that are close to zero, and finally in the limit it will be just one point, just this point, and then we will have f at point zero. We also can talk about translate of delta shaped functions. So when if we translate this bump from zero, from the neighborhood of zero to some fixed point A, and in that case what happens if we compute if we again consider a continuous function, so now everything will be multiplied by zero except for this neighborhood of point A, and in the limit we will get f at A. So basically we have here very interesting interpretation. So if we have a continuous function, when we move our delta function along, we can see different values of this function. So we can think of an arbitrary continuous function as a continuous linear combination of translations of delta functions concentrated at points A, right, with coefficients f of A, right? So that was an interesting property that was comment about the convolution. Also, we can say about a physical interpretation of delta x, say minus A, as we can think of that as the density of a unit point mass or charge. And next property is homogeneity. And so the question is our function homogeneous? And let me remind you of the definition. So a function f is homogeneous of degree m if for any positive number lambda, f of lambda x equals lambda 2 to the power m f of x. And so let's compute, let's check what happens with our delta function. If we plug instead of x here lambda x, and then do the substitution y equals lambda x, then we can see that delta function is homogeneous with m equals negative 1. So homogeneous of degree negative 1. And what is another example of such function? That would be function 1 over x, right? Also function homogeneous of degree negative 1. And let's make one more comment about this property. Say, what if we plug negative number instead of a positive? So if lambda is positive as before, and here we put negative lambda, then by doing the same substitution, we can see that here will be 1 minus because of y, and also since we have to switch the limits, it will be another minus. So finally they will be cancelled out, and we will get again 1 over lambda. So we can write the following: for any lambda, either positive or negative, our delta function of lambda x is absolute value of 1 over lambda times delta x. And specifically what we can see from this property, if we take lambda to be negative 1, we will have that delta of negative x equals delta x. So the function is even. So how we can understand a derivative of delta function? So if we write this integral and here put prime, meaning derivative, and then I recall that we think of delta function as delta shape functions and write expression like that, and then we just do integration by parts, then this term, since it's involved delta shape function evaluated far from the origin, then it will be zero, and then we will just have this second integral with the sign minus. So we, if we assume that, say, our function f is continuously differentiable, then we will be able to compute derivative in this generalized sense. Or if instead of, say, delta prime at x, we have delta prime at x minus a, it will be clear how to have a modification. So here that'll be f prime at a, and also if we want to compute derivative of higher order, assuming that our function f is continuously differentiable the appropriate number of times, then we can do integration by parts again, and then we can compute higher derivatives of delta functions. I will comment on that a little bit later. So again, and here are examples. Say if we want to compute this integral, then it must be our if our function f is just x and x at 0 will be 0, and if we need to compute say integral like this, then integral of the first term would be 1, and if we apply the formula we just discussed, we will get that we have to put minus, and then derivative of function x would be 1, so we will get 1 minus 1, it is 0. So now let's make a few comments about delta function in n-dimensional space. So here we will have a straight x that will be vector of all independent variables, and then delta x, Dirac's delta function, can be defined as a product of delta x1, delta x2, and so on. And since the product of delta and then each of them is understood as a limit of delta shape function when epsilon goes to zero, and so since the product of delta shape functions is a delta shape function, then we will have say similar properties. And so here, for instance, I sketched a delta shaped function depending on two variables. So what would be the degree of homogeneity? So this would be if every function is homogeneous of degree negative 1, then in n-dimensional space we will get homogeneous functions of degree negative n. And also for any continuous function we can have similar formulas that we had before. And the derivative of delta function in this n-dimensional space, kth derivative, can be defined similarly to what I just discussed, and for any function f that is continuously differentiable k times. So now I want to say a few words about generalized functions or distributions, because delta function is a general example of generalized functions, and generalized functions are typically studied in the course of functional analysis. And concept of generalized functions reflects the fact that a physical quantity cannot be measured at a point. It only can be, in reality, measured just in small neighborhoods of a point. So a mean value of a small, sufficiently small neighborhood can be measured. And formally, generalized functions are defined as continuous linear functionals on some vector space of, so say, good functions that are called test functions or bump functions. And so let's be a little bit more specific. So we can define the space of test functions, and the standard notation is this D of omega, and omega is an open set in n-dimensional space. And the elements are functions phi elements of this space. They are good functions, good in the sense that they are infinitely differentiable functions, and they have a compact support in omega, in our domain omega. So it means supported, it means they are take non-zero values only on some compound. And convergence in this space, convergence of test functions is defined as follows. So we can take a sequence of function phi, and we say that it converges to function phi as j goes to infinity if for any multi-index alpha. So here I'm just explaining what multi-index is. So if we have a function and we differentiate it, it depends on x variables, and we differentiate it with respect to x1 alpha 1 times, x2 alpha 2 times, say xn alpha n times. So, and if we add all of these derivatives, we'll get this multi-index alpha. And if we said that this function in our space can be differentiated infinitely many times, so we will be able to compute all derivatives. So the condition is, for any multi-index alpha, this derivative of order alpha, not only order alpha, but for any combination, converges uniformly to this derivative of our function phi in the domain open set omega as g goes to infinity, right? So this is a kind of unusual condition. So not only uniform convergence, but uniform convergence all derivatives. And the second exists a compact in omega such that supports of all functions phi g belongs to this compact, right? So they all have a support. So we cannot talk about convergence if one function has support here, another there, so they all have support. just on some compact in omega. And then, so this was a space of test functions. And then we will be talking about space of generalized functions. It's a dual space. It's a space and standard notation is D and here prime. Prime is not derivative, it's just notation. And this is a space of linear continuous functionals. So for any element of for any test function, we assign a complex number. This complex number is just u phi. U is our functional, and properties are, as I mentioned, it's linear. So if we have two elements, two test functions, and two complex numbers, then the functional, since it's linear, satisfies this usual linear property, and it is continuous. So if we have phi j that converges to zero in the sense of our test function space, the sense that was explained here, as g approaches infinity, then our functionals, so our complex numbers, converges to zero as j goes to infinity. So convergence in this space of generalized function defined as follows. So uj converges to generalized function u if this converges, this converges to this number as j goes to infinity for every test function. And also comment that if function u of x is a locally integrable function in omega, then we can define generalized function as this integral. And example of a generalized function, example of generalized function in this space is our delta function, Dirac's delta function, which we discussed earlier and gave it this meaning. And also we can comment that derivative of generalized functions are defined as follows, also in a similar way that we discussed for when we were talking about delta functions. So now I want to make another comment about a generalized derivative. It was introduced even prior to introduction of generalized functions. And so let's talk about v would be derivative of function u with multi-index alpha, and it can be defined using this formula. So now where this formula is coming from, so how we can derive this formula? And we can actually just start with a divergence theorem. So we know divergence theorem in three-dimensional space from calculus, but we also know that there is Stokes theorem, which holds in Rn, for instance, right? And it's easy to understand from here that due to Stokes theorem, divergence theorem in this form will hold in n-dimensional space. And now if f is a vector with n components and n is outward unit normal, then the divergence theorem could be written in this form. And then what we can do, we can take only one component. For instance, we can think of all of the components of vector f to be zero, and only fl is not zero. Then from this formula follows this one, right? That df dxl over the omega will be integral to integral along the boundary of the boundary of also fl times the corresponding just component of our unit normal. And then we take this formula, and then we, for fl, we will plug a product u and v, and assume that u and v are continuously differentiable function in the closure of domain omega. And then we put them there, and then we can differentiate this product, and if we differentiate this product, we can create some sort of formula for integration by parts, which is convenient when we study PDEs. So if we move one of the terms to the other side, then we will get that du dxl dv equals negative u dv dxl and plus this boundary term. And now let's assume that u is continuously differentiable k times, and instead of v, we take another function, say we take our infinitely differentiable function with compact support, so it will, we will have zero on the boundary, so this integral will disappear, and then from here we will get just this formula, right? And if we differentiate by parts, so this is our formula, integration by parts, if we integrate by parts, say k times, then we will come here. And finally, if we introduce this notation, we will arrive to this formula that can be taken as a definition of generalized derivative, which we were using. Now let's go back to the previous lecture, where we were trying to find a spherically symmetric solution, radial solution, and we found these solutions. This formula good for three-dimensional space and higher spaces, and this formula is good for two-dimensional space and omega, and here it's just the surface area of the unit sphere in the corresponding space. And from today's consideration, we also know that delta function is also spherically symmetric. So now we can say that fundamental solution for Laplace, for the Laplacian, for this differential operator, is a solution to this equation. So Laplacian of u equals delta function. And let me remind you again that the fundamental solution is not defined uniquely, because if we add here any harmonic function of solutions with zero, it still will satisfy this equation. And now, what is the physical meaning of our fundamental solution? So if we go a couple of lectures back, when we were talking about physical examples where Laplace equation is involved, then physical meaning of our fundamental solution, it is a potential of unit point charge or unit mass located at a point. So if we have delta of x, it means located at the origin, the zero. If we have a translation, x minus point, then located at this point. And then if you go back to this lecture with physical examples, then we know that the gradient of this potential is just the field that is created by this charge or this mass. And also I want to show connections of fundamental solution and solution to the Poisson's equation. Poisson equation is an equation where we have delta u equals f of x. Then this theorem is that let f be continuous and have support in a bounded domain omega, so it's outside of omega, it equals zero. Then there exists a solution of the Poisson's equation given by this formula. And if we look at this formula, so u here is solution to the Poisson's equation, and here we have integral over our omega, domain omega, where function f takes values different from zero. And then if we put here our fundamental solution, then if we compute the Laplacian of this, say in the left hand side we put the Laplacian, and here since Laplacian we differentiate with respect to x variables, we will move it here under the integral, then Laplacian of the fundamental solution of u sub zero will give us delta function at x minus y. And then if we look at the integral of f and delta, we will get f of x according to what we've been discussing today. So thank you.